Oh, hello. My name is Mara, and welcome to Books Like Woe. So, I've got a discussion video for you guys today, because there's been a little controversy brewing in Romancelandia over the last couple of years about some notable changes in how books are being marketed in terms of their cover design. And that kind of led me to think through, like, what makes a good cover? I know that I think towards the beginning of my channel, I had a video comparing good and bad cover designs, in my opinion, by genre. So if I can find that, I'll link that somewhere. But I thought I'd revisit this topic in light of that particular discussion because there has been some kind of, I'm about to make this sound like it's been like a blood war or something, and it's not that deep, guys, but there has been some, you know, heated or pointed discussion in various romance blogs and on romance Twitter and things like that about this evolving cover design trend that we are seeing for a lot of more mainstream romances these days. And that is that we are seeing a lot more sort of like illustrated type covers for romances, particularly romances that are more on the lighter end or the more romantic comedy end. And there is a lot of sort of division. So before I start actually getting into this, I should kind of show you what I'm talking about. So when you think of a traditional romance cover, I picked a few from my shelves that I think are closer to what a lot of people kind of think of. So back in the day, there was the traditional clinch, and this is a prized possession, guys. This is the first romance I ever read. I tracked down a used copy. It's called The Marriage Deal. This girl's name is Ashley. This guy's name is Diego. She has a femillet, and the actual dynamics of their romance are kind of horrifying now that I look back on this as an adult, but anyway. But you can see this has like the traditional clinch. This is a Harlequin, and this is very clearly like this style of cover is very well known as like, that's a romance cover. So what is very much at the forefront is both the fact that like there are two people who are the center of the story and that there's a strong sexual or romantic dynamic between the two of them. So that's like a very traditional clinchy type cover. Other kind of more traditional covers. So this is one for The Midwinter Mail Order Bride by Kati Wilde. So again, big dude, you can see a lot of his skin. She's sort of like provocatively dressed. I love this because this is such a fun, campy fantasy romance. I really love this cover, but it is more on the traditional end. I think it's very sort of like sexuality forward. Another Kati Wilde one that's very similar. Again, the clinch, two people in an embrace. In this case, they are both very scantily clad, which is again, often true for romances that are more, that have a higher heat level. And then a more, I would argue a more tasteful version of this trend is the Duchess deal. So yes, like his shirt is part way off there, definitely kissing. But the focus here is not quite as much on the sexuality. It's a little bit more on the romance. And I don't know, I just in general, I think this is a little more tasteful version of this type of cover. And even in describing it that way, I may have tipped my hand that I don't particularly like this tradition of romance covers, but a lot of people really, really do. So I'm gonna link below two articles that were on Book Riot kind of describing pros and cons for this new trend, which is much more on the side of like kind of a animated version of romance cover. So like this is a new cover from Penny Reid. Let me flash up what the original cover looked like. This is now, you can very clearly see that this is like a romantic comedy in terms of what she's trying to pitch you. It's cartoon. It doesn't have a lot of like sex forwardness in the illustration. It's very cartoony. Another example would be Well Met. So we do see two people on the cover, but they're again illustrated. And this is much more, part of what is being discussed is that this doesn't necessarily read in terms of the visual cues on the covers like a traditional romance. It reads much more maybe like a chick lit or women's fiction, or even YA, kind of more what the illustrated style communicates to some people. Some other prominent examples this year, sorry, I've got a bunch of books, so you're gonna see me reaching around a lot in this video. A couple of other prominent examples this year were The Bride Test by Helen Hoang. So there was also The Kiss Quotient had a more illustrated cover as well, but this takes it sort of a step further. And then The Unhoneymooners by Christina Lauren. So these are books that if you just casually pick them up in the bookstore, you might think that they were just like general contemporaries. You might think that they were chick lit. You might think that they're women's fiction. You might think that they're just sort of a lighter version of sort of general fiction. They don't scream romance in the same way. And so again, there are some people who really don't like this trend at all. They feel like it is essentially that for good or for ill, the more clinchy covers have traditionally been what screams romance, and that to go away from this is to sort of act like, you know, people should be ashamed that they're reading romance. There's nothing wrong with picking up a book that has a cover like this. We should, you know, not be ashamed that there's smut in these books sometimes. We shouldn't be ashamed that the main dynamic is between two people. And they like the more traditional covers. I probably have tipped my hand at this already. For me, I tend to disagree with that. So I do think that if you have a more angsty type romance, a cover like this, I agree, would not be appropriate. I think that would be false advertising because this reads as sort of lighter fare, just sort of like more comedic, lighthearted book, just through the kind of cover conventions here. And I will tell you, I think one cover that somewhat falls in this category is Bringing Down the Duke. I absolutely love this cover. I think it's beautiful. But I do think that the cover is communicating a more lighthearted tone than what the book itself actually has. And in that case, I would be more sympathetic to the argument of, like, we shouldn't have these cartoony or less explicitly romance covers on romances because it sets a wrong expectation for readers picking it up. Circling all the way back around to what the original kind of question for this video is what makes a good cover? And for me, a good cover is one that prompts you to pick up that book, that prompts the right reader to pick up a book that will fit them. And therefore, I think that a lot of these like lighter romances getting these more cartoony covers or these less traditional romance covers is a great development. It is leading people who would not normally feel comfortable identifying themselves as a romance reader to try a romance. So like I've seen this book on a lot of channels that I wouldn't normally see a romance being read on. Like it comes to mind Thoughts on Tomes. I know she read this particular book and really liked it earlier. Sam did. I have given this to a number of my friends who don't consider themselves to be romance readers, but you know, they'll pick up something lighter in the summer or lighter when they're traveling, and they've really enjoyed this. I've done the same for Well Met. Both of those books are romances, but they have, I think, crossover appeal to non-romance readers because of the kinds of books that they are, some of the subject matter that they're tackling, the level of smut that's in them. Like, they have a cross genre appeal. So I think it's actually entirely appropriate that when publishers are seeing books that have that kind of crossover appeal, that they're taking advantage of that and putting covers on those books that are likely to attract people who wouldn't normally pick up a romance. So while I understand why some romance readers may feel kind of resentful or trepidatious or annoyed that books that have always been marketed to them in a certain way are now being marketed slightly differently and are kind of signaling new things to new readers who might be coming into the genre, like I can understand that. I think for me, one thing is that I don't think that romance covers have always been only the clench. That was sort of the examples that I was showing in terms of some traditional romance covers. But even going back to like the 80s, they would have covers that had like pretty lace fans or like a mysterious castle or whatever. Like we've definitely had in romance covers in the past that have been more like object oriented, and for good or for ill, I will say that the 50 Shades books kind of revived that trend for a while in romance covers, that it has sort of like these very artfully shot objects. So the 50 Shades did that, and then like the Billionaire series from Jessica Clare had that same kind of thing. There was a series from Maya Banks that did that, and that was for a while, and actually I think still, a way to communicate a more erotic romance in a way that wasn't as literal in terms of two naked people together on the cover. So anyway, with that little like trip down the history of romance covers to the side, I just thought that I would kind of talk through some examples of what I think does make good cover design, because I do. I think that these new ones, The Bride Test, The Unhoneymooners, Well Met, you'll notice a lot of these are from Berkeley, by the way. I feel like they've been kind of some of the cutting edge people on this trend. But then also self-pubbed authors like Penny Reid. Like, I think these are all great cover designs for more lighthearted romance novels. So I thought I would go through some other covers that I think do a good job of drawing people in, and kind of maybe we can come to a theory of the case of overall what makes a good cover if we accept my definition of something that draws the right reader into reading that book. So for first books in series, or I guess I picked a couple of sequels, but in general, like for books that are really trying to entice a new reader, I think one of the best things that you can do with your cover design is to set a mood. And one group that I think does a really good job of this is Tor. I think it's Tor.com, right? Yeah. Tor.com with these littler books. I think that they've had some really nice cover design for both the Wayward Children series and the Murderbot Diary series, because I think what these do is they really effectively communicate sort of the mood or atmosphere of what these particular sci-fi fantasy books are doing. So for this one, this door in the middle of nowhere with sort of the sun setting and the kind of creepy forest behind it, I think evokes this sense of sort of whimsy, something fantastical, but also I think a little bit of like, ooh, like menace. You know, when you see trees, you think scariness a lot of times in fantasy books. And then I just love the kind of imagery of Murderbot, the sec unit, sort of just solitary figure in this sort of vaguely menacing sci-fi type background, because the Murderbot Diaries are such a character-driven series that I think spotlighting Murderbot front and center was a great choice, and also really effectively communicates the genre and sort of the overall kind of atmosphere of these books. So I think that they've done a really good job recently. A few other ones that I think do a good job of evoking a certain tone and enticing someone to read it who may not have known about it. So this is An English Murder by Cyril Hare. And this is a great example of a cover buy in some ways, or at least the cover enticing me to pick up a book that I had never heard of, but that ended up being a book that was perfect for me and that I really, really liked. And that is because I think on this cover, you see the red. So it says An English Murder. You see the red, white, and snow. So this is communicating Christmas, I think, pretty effectively. But also because of the dripping red, you can clearly see the murder perspective or the murder bit. And, you know, it's called An English Murder, so you know that. So I think that this, in terms of communicating, like, the snowy mystery, this is fantastic cover design, because when I looked at this, I immediately thought, oh, I wonder if that's an isolated closed circle mystery, which it turned out to be. And they were able to do that just purely through the overall cover design without me even looking at the back. I already had picked it up and thought I probably was gonna buy it just because the visual language on this told me what kind of whodunit or murder mystery it was. Similarly, I think the Hazel Wood is a great example of cover design, because it has a lot of different elements to it. So it's got, like, you see the stabbing hand, you see some forest, you see some like whimsical elements, but then you also see the city, you see a car and some roads. So you get from this cover sort of like a between two worlds atmosphere and kind of the whole portal fantasy bit of this. Now, I know that this was a very polarizing book, but I personally feel like even just from the cover, you kind of get the kind of two halves of what this book is trying to do. Also, I just think purely in terms of enticing a reader, this is just beautifully designed with the foiling. It's a very welcoming book, I think, and very eye-catching. So I think this could definitely attract some readers just with its vibe. And then two fantasy picks that I just think did, I think throughout their series, now I haven't seen the final cover for this one, but the covers on the Book of the Ancestors series, I just think were really beautiful, this version of the covers. Like, it always has these strong women kind of like facing the reader, very clear. This one, I picked this one because she clearly has like blood on her and there's a sword, and like what these covers convey are like strong, brutal women. And because Nona is such the heart of this series, again, I think it's really smart to spotlight her as the main focus of the covers, and then to put her in sort of like a vaguely threatening atmosphere, definitely, I think, is a very effective communication of the overall tone of this particular fantasy series. And then last but not least, I just think that these Poppy Wars covers, I haven't seen the third one, like I said, but I think that this really is beautifully drawn. And I think what this does a good job of doing is evoking a non-Western setting for this fantasy world in a really artistic way. And I also think that it communicates some of like the mysticism or magic of these books really well. It's a very simple design. It's not like this is super elaborate, but I just think that the kind of watercolor element and the way that the letters are sort of fading, this does a really good job, I think, of sort of the kind of cultural heritage of these books. So I think that this was an effective cover design as well. Oh, and sorry, I keep just keep just finding more and more books that I pulled. I pulled like a huge pile of them here. I just wanted to shout out Jane Steele. I think that this does a really great, this is a, to me a great example of abstract cover design that's really thoughtful, because if you just sort of look at it at a glance, I think it does read as some sort of historical fiction just because it's got like this lace cover and the kind of font. But then when you look closely, the things that are making up the lace all have to do with murder. So it's also sort of communicating that there's something a little different about this historical fiction book. So I thought this is a great example of smart cover design that rewards, you know, looking at it more closely. Next, I thought we could talk about effective cover design for nonfiction. So I think nonfiction has a slightly different job to do than fiction covers do. Like I said, my kind of theory of the case is that for a fiction book, a big part of what they need to do is kind of communicate to you like genre, tone, and atmosphere in their cover. Versus I think for nonfiction, people tend to come to it for a much more sort of like tactical reason, like they have a specific reason why they're seeking out nonfiction of that kind, unless they just generally sort of like nonfiction. But generally, there's often sort of drier covers on nonfiction. I do think for more narrative nonfiction, so like I'll Be Gone in the Dark, there's a little bit more room to evoke kind of a mood or an atmosphere. But in general, often what nonfiction is trying to do is like just tell you about something. So often what they need to do is sort of stick to being very like, or not very, but at least somewhat more literal in their cover designs. So I thought that I would pick two examples where the subject matter is a little bit controversial or maybe a little bit taboo in some ways. And I thought that both of these covers did a great job of sort of like maybe inviting somebody in to check out the book more than they would if it was a more literal cover design. So first, this is one of my all-time favorite covers, Come As You Are by Emily Nagoski. This is essentially about women's sexuality, and just the visual pun here for female genitalia, I think is really effective and very playful. I think it communicates that this is a sciencey book that is not gonna be like difficult for you to read, or like is going to have a very kind of approachable tone. So I thought that this is a great way to sort of have fun with the subject matter and entice somebody to pick something up that might be intimidating to them otherwise. And then with The Color of Law by Richard Rothstein, so this is essentially a book about how the US government set up its laws and zoning practices to essentially allow white people to accumulate property in the post-World War II era at the expense of non-white peoples being able to kind of build generational wealth through property. So that's kind of like a heavy topic and also something that might make people feel sort of defensive. So I think the fact that this is somewhat of an abstract or like non-obvious cover is to its benefit, because if you know what the book is about, this map is exactly like this, there's no obfuscation at all because this is literally showing the redlining practices on a map. But it doesn't like, it doesn't necessarily scream that this is a book about like government injustices or something that has to do with like race history, which I think can be something that they wouldn't pick up by themselves. So I actually quite like that this cover is both literal and non-literal. Like, I guess what I mean by that is I could, there's a world where you could design the cover to show a photograph from the civil rights era. And I just frankly think that there are people who seeing that would automatically discount this book. But I think the fact that this is a different kind of literal cover is actually very smart. The fact that it's like an old timey map is communicating that it's some kind of history. And in that way, I think that it's a smart approach for a cover for a topic that might be controversial for some readers to maybe help them have their defenses lowered a little bit and pick up a book that they would ultimately really like, because this is like a fantastic history and something I would really recommend to a lot of people, and is very, very interesting. So anyway, I just think that this is effective cover design and an effective approach for more, you know, controversial subjects. And then actually circling back to the romance, I just thought I would show you two romance covers that I think are really effective and are neither in the super illustrated trend I was talking about earlier, nor do they fall into the very traditional version of romances. So I think that Courtney Milan has some of the most beautiful covers in historical romances. She's giving us like the dress porn, basically, like the beautiful, like luscious gown, but it's not the clench. And I love the way that on several of her books, like this kind of sweeping dress is at center stage, and this communicates that her books are very character driven, that they're usually very focused on our female lead, and this has sort of become her hallmark. So when you see a cover like this with this font, you know it's one of hers. And then Mariana Zapata, actually, I think in general has pretty good covers. I think that this is a great example of sort of the abstract romance trend. So you can kind of see from this, like you can sort of see skin, like this is sort of an abstract romance cover that is familiar to people who read romance, like this kind of bold, this type of font, the way that it's laid out. If I were scrolling through, I would know that this was a romance cover, but it's not as literal. So again, I use this sort of as an example to push back against the idea that only the clench is a true romance cover. This is very much in line with the cover designs of romances that are being published today. And to people who read a lot of romance, this definitely reads as genre appropriate if you were like scrolling through Kindle. And two more categories. So first of all, I thought we could talk about sequel cover designs and how people have an opportunity to use sequel cover designs before even a full description of the books have come out to communicate to returning readers why they should continue with the series. So first, I absolutely love Rebecca Roanhorse's Six World covers. I think they're beautiful. But this in particular, I think is a really effective sequel cover design because right here on the front, you see what will be our three main characters. So a huge part of this book is basically a girl gang roaming through the post-apocalyptic wasteland. And you see like these tough women in these aggressive poses with weapons. You see the, you know, hot fire burning in the background. You see a car overturned. So like, just with the image of this, you have an idea of possibly what's going to go down in the second book, because we definitely have met this character before. So anyway, this I think is a really great example of enticing readers to return with a sequel cover design. And then I thought I would mention Johannes Cabal the Detective as a great example of sequel cover design because each book in the Johannes Cabal series is playing with slightly different genres and different tropes. They're all centering around Johannes Cabal and they're all set in this sort of steampunky fantasy world, but they all have a different kind of plot engine. And this one is all about mystery. So I think that this does a, you know, it's got the big question mark on it. It still has the continuity from the earlier books of this red, cream and black kind of palette and the sort of graphic steampunky element, but he's dressed much more like you would expect maybe like Sherlock Holmes to be dressed or Hercule Poirot. He's sort of dressed like a traditional English detective. And then we also have our setting, which is a dirigible. So I think that this does a great job of signaling that yes, it's still the same character and this is still the same series, but it tells you a little bit about what's different in this particular sequel book. Okay, and then finally, I thought we could talk about books that are primarily created as collection items, because to me, those covers are definitely doing something different than a book that is just sort of generally produced. So I have a few different examples. So one way to make a collection book unique is if it is a older book to have facsimile editions or facsimile covers. So in this case, the appeal is that this looks exactly like the original Agatha Christie edition, but it is a brand new copy. So that is one route you can go. The UK has been doing these fun editions of certain sort of like modern classic fantasy. So like I have, this is The Blade Itself. I also have The Lies of Loch Lomora in a series like this. And it's sort of getting to this, so it's a more like a cloth-bound hardback kind of situation. So it's a little nicer than some of the trade paperbacks that fantasies usually get published in. It still has like really nice cover design to it. And then you can get this matching series of something that maybe isn't like an all-time classic yet, but it's definitely a modern classic and definitely has a very loyal audience who would love to have sort of more luxe editions of some beloved books. So I know that they have a few, I'm not sure what all series they have in this, but I think that this is a smart route to get lovers of a book to buy it, which is to produce something more solid and something that feels more special. And then my favorite cover in the entire Penguin Clothbound collection is this particular one of Don Quixote. But again, another route to, in terms of enticing collectors to buy things, is just to have a unique eye-catching cover design. And I definitely think the Clothbound Classics qualify for that. I know a lot of people, we will talk about this in my Penguin Clothbound collection video at the end of the year. A lot of people have issues with the quality of the actual books. I have not had those problems, but I hear you. I know before you leave a comment, I know. But in terms of just like an aesthetic object, the fact that they've gotten Coralie Bickford Smith to design these very eye-catching, interesting, and unique. There's not really additions like this in other classics lines, I think was a really smart marketing move and clearly has been paying off because these very well, they continue to add additions into the series. And I just think that this is an effective way to get somebody to buy an object that they can get for free, right? Because most of these books are in the public domain. If I wanted to get an ebook for free, I could of any of these, but to get somebody to buy the physical object, it needs to be a little bit special in terms of the collection. And I guess you could say the same thing about these, I think these are HarperCollins editions from the UK. You know, they have the foiling on the front of them. There's only a few of them. They're not widely available, so that entices people to buy them. And then this Barnes & Noble leather edition, same kind of thing. Something unique, different, entices people to buy them. And then finally, another way you can do it is to make it a series. So these Everyman's Library ones, they look really nice on my shelves with all their spines matching. If you can kind of build that branding of the red spine or the black spine sometimes, and somebody has a choice of which edition they're going to get something in, and you don't have exclusive publishing rights to it, having that sort of unique branding is definitely a way to entice people to pick your edition over a different one. So anyway, those are some of my thoughts about what makes a good cover design or an effective cover design. Obviously, that's very subjective because something that's enticing to me may not be enticing to you and vice versa. I think that, as with anything, so much of this just boils down to personal tastes and personal aesthetics and whatever. But, you know, I think that in terms of what a good cover should be doing, I think that you want to find that right reader for that right book. And I say that because I think that if you mispromise something with what the cover is communicating, that can be a bad thing. That can make somebody put a book down and ultimately not buy another book from that author. So it's this tricky line between you're wanting to entice people in, but you're not wanting to sort of like overpromise or miscommunicate with what you're enticing them in with, if that makes sense. So anyway, those are all of my ramblings. Hopefully I've edited that together to be somewhat more coherent than it felt when I was saying it. But let me know what you guys think about cover design, because I think it, like I was saying, it's very personal and what appeals to me may not appeal to you. So maybe let me know one of your favorite cover designs that's come out recently, maybe a cover you didn't like. Yeah, I'd love to hear from you guys below. Like I said, this is a discussion video, so I open it up to you to discuss below in the comments. And yeah, I think that will do it for me. So yeah, I hope you guys enjoyed this video. And if you did, please like, subscribe, follow me on the social medias if you are so inclined. I have all of that information listed in the description box below. And I think that will do it. I hope you guys are having an absolutely lovely day, and I will just talk to you soon. Bye.